Good morning. I'm State Senator Kevin Parker, and this is another episode of Battle of the Senators. Oh, I'm sorry. Sorry, Senate Standing Committee. The Senate Standing Committee on Energy and Telecommunications. I want to thank my colleagues for being here, Senator Matera, Senator Borrello, Senator Mannion, Senator Gonzalez. We have a special guest, Doreen Harris. Sorry.
Yeah.
Yes, Doreen Harris.
The
president of NYSERDA. I'm sorry. All week I've been calling Doreen Harris Adrian Harris. So, you know, too many Harrises in the administration. So Doreen Harris, the president of NYSERDA, who's going to field some questions from the committee. And as always, we have the intrepid Justin Chairs, who is the committee director, and Mo Bean, no last name, just Mo Bean like Cher, and, you know, Prince, the committee counselor. Any questions, comments, concerns before we get started? Thank you so much. Mr. Chairs, let's begin with the agenda.
First bill number 378A, sponsor Senator Parker. An act to amend the energy law in relation to establishing a program for eligible renewable hydrogen.
Any questions, comments, concerns?
Move the bill.
The bill's moved, seconded. The bill is moving to finance. Next.
Bill number 1791, sponsor Senator Hinchey. An act to amend the public service law, the environmental conservation law, and the state finance law in relation to reporting requirements and audits of private water companies.
Questions, comments, concerns about this bill? Bill is moved and seconded. The bill also will report to finance. Next.
Bill number 4579A, sponsor Senator Comrie. An act to amend the public service law and the public authorities law in relation to developing microgrids in preparation for extreme weather events and other risks to public security.
Bill is very timely. Any questions, comments, concerns about this bill? Yes, Senator Matera.
Not about this bill. Mm-hmm. I just want to thank you for the first bill.
Okay.
I'm sorry, I should have done that.
No.
That's
right.
You know what? That's very disrespectful.
No, not at all.
And I don't like to be disrespectful to my chairman.
Thank you very much. I appreciate you.
Till later.
Right, to the appropriate time. any other questions, comments, concerns on Senate Bill 4579A by Senator Comrie?
Move the bill.
The bill is moved and seconded. The bill is also moved to finance. Next.
Bill number 7336, sponsor Senator Parker. An act relating to wastewater treatment.
Questions, comments, concerns?
Mr. Chairman.
Yes. Senator.
Just a question. You know, I thought as of right now there was already a restriction on this. I know when I was county executive, Chautauqua County, our landfill was not allowed to accept any fracking materials from like Pennsylvania, which does a lot of fracking. So how is this, I guess, needed?
I think we're codifying it. It's not in statute.
So it's regulatory right now.
It is from what we understand policy from the perspective that is kind of the usage and custom, but not necessarily codified in law. Okay. So we're codifying it here.
Okay.
Any other questions, comments, concerns? The bill is moved and seconded.
AWR.
Without request, Senator Matera and Senator Burrell. This bill is moved to finance. Next.
Bill number 7641, sponsor Senator Mannion. An act to amend the canal law in relation to directing the Canal Corporation to create a chart to identify, map, and model normal and flood water flows in the Oswego River Basin and the Mohawk River Basin.
Questions, comments, concerns? Yes, comments by Senator Mannion.
Thank you, Chair, for bringing this forward. This is tied to previous legislation which we passed related to flood mitigation task force to focus in on the Oswego River and Mohawk River basins as they've experienced extreme flooding events and honestly sometimes a lack of coordination about that water flow. So this is state-of-the-art mapping that was part of a recommendation from that task force chaired by Brian Stratton. I commend them for meeting on time, producing a report on time, and the governor supporting recommendations related to that report, and this is one of them. So I appreciate you bringing it through committee.
Absolutely. Senator Matera, you had a question?
Move it.
Okay.
Sorry.
The bill is moved, the bill is seconded, and the bill is going to report to finance. Next.
Bill number 8212, sponsor Senator Parker. An act directing the New York State Energy Research and Development Authority study the feasibility of creating, storing, and transferring hydrogen energy to residential and commercial structures.
Questions, comments, concerns about this? Senator Burrell.
Okay, you want to go? No. Yeah, I just say in general, we already have green hydrogen that's actually being, you know, we have Plug Power in my district and so forth. So, I'm glad to see this is what kind of wrap it up and do a study, but it looks like we're already moving forward on this. So with this bill, essentially, study the practicality of making sure that we're able to get things like green hydrogen into the, you know, into the infrastructure. How's that? What will the purpose of this
be? So the purpose of this bill really is to look at hydrogen generally as part of the menu of energy options that we should have in the state as we move to a clean energy economy. I think that although hydrogen is being used in some very limited circumstances, there may be a more significant role in there, but there are also a lot of questions, particularly about the amount of resources that it takes to produce hydrogen. Much of what I'm seeing and hearing right now is that the production of hydrogen actually costs more than using it as an energy source, and so we need to look at that and figure out how do we maximize the use of hydrogen and what are the best ways and the best sources so that it's not just here and there, but it becomes a real part of our energy mix.
So you're saying just traditional hydrogen, green hydrogen, all hydrogen is not cost effective at the moment? Is that correct?
That is what I'm hearing. But I don't know that for certain, which is why I put in the bill to do a study.
Okay. All right. Thank you.
Any other questions, comments, concerns?
Move the bill.
The bill's been moved and seconded. The bill is moving to third reading. Next and last bill.
Bill number 8402, sponsor Senator Parker. An act to amend the public authorities law in relation to establishing the Go Green Schools Act to assist schools in converting to renewable energy sources as a primary source of energy.
Questions, comments, concerns? All right. The bill is moved and seconded. This bill also will move to third reading. Thank you, members of the committee.
This one, unbelievable.
It's a new day.
You see this with... It's a new day.
I try to be responsive to the members of the committee and address their concerns. So if there are more things that you think we should be focusing on,
yes,
please let Justin know. I'm not taking any complaints. And we'll try to get him on the agenda as soon as possible. Without any further ado, I want to have Doreen Harris, the president of NYSERDA, give some quick opening remarks and then take some questions from the committee. I want to thank President Harris, not just for making herself available today, but always making herself available to this committee. It's not her first time to this committee. She's not new to this, she's true to this. She's always been very fearless in coming to the committee, presenting the work of NYSERDA, and answering questions. But I also have found her super responsive as we've interacted outside of just the committee, when I've either had things happening in my district or things that policy questions that were happening in the state. When I reached out to her, her and her team have always been super responsive. And so I encourage my colleagues that if you have issues around energy, particularly stuff around energy efficiency, things around the CLCPA, don't hesitate to reach out to NYSERDA. They also have a ton of programming that can help our communities, and individual homeowners, commercial landlords, and such address, and as well as obviously large projects around generation and transmission and such. And as we kind of again transition into this clean energy economy, that this agency is part of the sharp end of the sword in the state of New York. So. Without any further ado, President Harris.
Well, thank you, Chair Parker. It's fantastic to see you as well as members of the committee today. Just a week out of the budget hearings, but certainly I'm excited to dig into any questions you may have following up on that hearing, mm-hmm. but also I think explicitly to discuss the ways that we at NYSERDA are implementing our climate law and notably doing so in a manner that aims to achieve the outcomes of course, the goal itself, but also the benefits that we know will come to our state with those investments. So as I said in last week's hearing, there is no question that we are working with a very ambitious climate law and a very rapid transition to those goals, both in the near, mid, and long term. But all in all, I would say we remain as committed as ever to delivering clean energy goals and the emission limits, and also realizing the investments that are going to result in greater health and economic benefits across New York. So a couple of work streams that are underway that I think, you know, will likely be the topic of discussion today, I'd say first is the Cap and Invest program that NYSERDA and DEC have been instructed by the governor to implement, not only from the perspective of reducing greenhouse gas emissions, but also to ensure a sustainable and affordable future for New Yorkers. So you may recall the 2024 enacted budget established a climate action fund, which is designed to defray costs of the program for New Yorkers every year, but also to launch investments toward the change that we are seeking. So as we speak, we have advanced the next phase of work to build out Cap and Invest, focusing on affordability. And there's a number of analyses underway and presented that are useful for broader understanding as we advance toward draft regulations later this year. Of course, we're advancing our work toward the state's 70 by 30 renewable electricity goal. As we speak, our current portfolio represents about 63% of our 2030 electricity needs. Certainly, it has been a challenging year in the face of renewable energy supply chain constraints and inflation pressures. We are executing on Governor Hochul's 10-point action plan to expand that industry here in New York. And indeed, in her executive budget, she proposed the Rapid Act, which is designed to streamline the build-out of transmission infrastructure akin to what we are advancing for large-scale renewables today. In addition, we at NYSERDA, I'm pleased to report, are advancing major investments associated with federal funding. As we speak, we have $1.2 billion of federal funds that we have either applied for or received as a result of various allocations from the federal government. And that leverages a major part of our work. We also are investing in our buildings, certainly through the Empower Plus program, which was also part of last year's budget, $200 million for low-income families to retrofit their homes, and also leveraging federal funds through the Department of Energy. And in fact, in December, we were among the first to submit an application to the Department of Energy for the Home Electrification and Appliance Rebate Program. Also this year, we've advanced the New York Sun program even more. We remain the number one community solar market in the nation. And this year, we propose to expand the successful Solar for All program through authorization of the Public Service Commission to build out this program statewide for low-income consumers, which is a great opportunity to scale up community solar further. In addition, we've applied for $400 million in federal funding to further build out the New York Sun program, including through other agencies and the city itself. On transportation, certainly we have investments not only in zero-emission electric vehicles, but over $14 million in additional funding for the Drive Clean Rebate Program. I'm pleased to say we have nearly 200,000 EVs on the road in New York, with 13,000 charging stations installed statewide. And through the Clean Water, Clean Air, and Green Jobs Environmental Bond Act, we are now advancing $500 million to school districts to ensure they can begin the transition to zero-emission school bus fleets as well. And this would not be accomplished without the support of more than 171,000 clean energy workers across our state, a number that is expected to roughly double in the coming decades as we effectuate not only the climate law, but the training programs that are necessary to ensure even the state's most underserved population continues to benefit from these investments. So clearly, we are hard at work implementing our climate law, and I'm pleased to be here today to talk about any questions you might have. Thank you.
Members of the committee, any questions? Senator Burrell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, President Harris, for being here. Appreciate it. Last week, during the committee hearings, we asked about what's the cost going to be of this. I think your response was we're working diligently towards getting a cost of this total conversion, the total conversion of our economy. Where are we in that process, and what resources are being allocated to ensure that we know what the cost is?
Well, certainly. I know there had been a request made to provide the full spending that's going on today in Climate Act implementation. I know we're coordinating with other agencies to provide those numbers as it relates to what is, in fact, multiple funding streams contributing toward the goals. When we advance policies, we always look at the costs, and we always look at the benefits, and we look at the impacts thereof. Certainly, with respect to Cap and Invest, we have just produced a very extensive analysis that is available on the website around multiple different scenarios for Cap and Invest, which really lay out ways in which those trade-offs would be achieved, meaning a bigger Cap and Invest program would likely achieve greater emissions reductions, but conversely, of course, come at a greater cost for consumers.
This isn't Cap and Invest, it's just kind of a Hunger Games for people that can afford it. They can buy the ability, the permission to pollute. That's kind of what the Cap and Invest is. So isn't that a diminishing return as you drive those people out of the fossil fuel industry? How is Cap and Invest going to work in a sense? It's like you're basically saying we're transitioning to green energy that's completely subsidized from people that are actually supposed to be providing reliable, affordable energy currently. So how will Cap and Invest work in the long term if basically we're driving those folks out of business?
Well, one aspect of Cap and Invest that was part of last year's budget, I think, is probably the most critical part, which is to say that we have collectively committed to the Climate Action Fund, which is intended for that very reason, to hold harmless, and in fact, our analysis would show to potentially benefit low to moderate income New Yorkers in providing rebates to them on an annual basis. I completely agree with you. This is a complex, multi-decade transition, and it is one that needs to be accompanied by very close attention paid to consumer costs, because clearly affordability is central not only to the governor's priorities, but the ways in which you'll see these scenarios playing out.
I know it's multi-decade, but we're starting like immediately, like next year with some of these reductions. The green, the EV bus mandate for our schools, which starts in 2027, you can't buy anything but an electric bus in 2027. I appreciate that you understand the practical side of it, but that doesn't really jive with the CLCPA and the Climate Action Council's requirements. So that's understandable, but I don't think you and my colleagues are on the same page when it comes to how quickly we should be doing this. But so let's go back to Cap and Invest. I just kind of have a basic question. If you are driving these folks out of the state, they're no longer going to produce energy here. They're obviously going to ramp up their operations in other states. Most of these companies are, operate multi-state. So what are we doing to ensure that only green energy is coming to the state? We're importing more power now than we ever have. We're going to have to import more to keep the lights on, especially in New York City. So are we going to be ramping up our importing of fossil fuel generated electricity, or are we going to cut it off?
Well, let me start with the aspect of economic growth here in the state. In fact, when we really look at how Cap and Invest will function, we have ways in which we can ensure that these energy-intensive and exposed industries don't leave. And the rationale there is, of course, twofold. First, we want economic development to remain here in the state. But second, of course, if they go to another state and emit, that's not benefiting anyone,
correct? That's right. That's the whole problem. This is a shell game.
So we certainly have a couple of ways we're looking at to ensure this. First, as I had indicated, we have the Climate Action Fund, 3% of which is intended to offset costs for industrial and small businesses. So that's one aspect of this that I think will be put to good use. Also, there's ways in which we can distribute allowances to those energy-intensive industries for those reasons. Because indeed, I would completely agree with you, there are challenges with electrifying some aspects of manufacturing in particular and industrial accounts as well. So when we look at the ways in which we can design Cap and Invest, we can see ways to ensure that those mutual outcomes can be obtained. But it is complex.
So there's a plan in place. to keep people from moving their operations to other states where they're going to just emit things there and in the end have no positive impact on greenhouse gas emissions. So you have a plan to keep people here?
That's one of the fundamental questions before us when we look at the design, the pre-proposal outline that is available now for Cap and Invest. It's laying out various decision points that in part are intended to get to those outcomes.
Well, you know, right now it's saying, and again, there's no details, but about a third of proceeds are going to keep costs, we're going to give away money to people to make sure that their energy bills don't go up. Okay, so that's about a third of it. Two-thirds is for climate investments. But there's no really discussion on, you know, the economic development impact. Where is it in that fund? Are we going to actually use money to ensure that businesses aren't leaving New York State because they can't afford to do business here anymore with these mandates?
Let me jump in here just really quickly, Senator Morello, just as the person who actually wrote the initial legislation on Capital Invest. The notion, first of all, the notion of how we deal with climate change, again, I've said this a number of times, both in this committee meeting as well as other places, that this problem is a global problem. We're not going to solve it in New York. We need to do our part. We need to provide leadership, right? And so that's part of what we're doing. But eventually, we need a U.S., federal government that wholly leans into the fact that we have a climate crisis and that we need to create an energy plan to address that. And then go into a multinational compact with other countries in order for us to address the global problem, right? So we're just in this moment just trying to address our own issues internally so that by the time that wave comes that we will be ahead of the wave. And be able to hopefully show other states how they can do it. We also understand that, for me, and I've said this again a number of times, the number one goal for me in this committee is keeping costs down. The second goal for me is getting generation, clean energy generation in the ground, right? Absolutely critical.
What about reliability?
Right? Reliability is always part of it. Resiliency is part of it, right? All those things, right? So all the themes that we always talk about in terms of energy don't go away just because we're moving to a clean energy economy. And so that we are trying to not necessarily, so you're talking about current generators. First of all, the vast majority of current generators are also moving to clean energy. But the other thing is that we're bringing in a number of new generation providers, right? Like a lot of the folks in the offshore wind space that we're about to do nine gigawatts of wind, hopefully, shortly, soon.
What about nuclear power? We never really discussed that.
That's a different question, but what I'm just trying to address is, so whatever comes in, right, and we've had last year during the committee, we did have Mr. Mulvaney, the head of ORES, who did say that nuclear is not something that
not
can't be
table.
Done. It's not off the table, but we also don't have currently any, or at least at the last time I spoke to him, did not have any applications to do any new nuclear in the state. But we also haven't gotten rid of the nuclear that exists. And I've also been on the record saying that
we should have done Indian Point.
I've always said that was one of the biggest mistakes that we've ever done.
I know, yes.
It's
a huge
problem, right? So, but here we are, right? And so the idea is to bring more generators in that are doing clean energy, right? And so the notion that, like, people are just leaving and we're not bringing anybody in. I want to make sure that everybody understands.
Yeah, the only way to do that is you have to understand people that generate traditional forms of power are able to actually make a profit and pay people. People that produce green energy do not. The only profit is from subsidies, period.
That's not true.
If we stop subsidizing green energy, there would never be an industrial scale wind or solar project ever built anywhere in the United States. That is just the case.
Senator Burrell, we also subsidize gas and oil. And we subsidize coal forever.
Yeah. Okay.
All right. There are exponentially more subsidies right now on the books in the United States on coal, oil and gas than there are in anything on clean energy.
Well,
that's
the
simple
question.
Fact.
I would question that.
Also. You can question all you want, but it still makes it the fact.
Let's focus on New York for the moment and
okay.
say this. If you're going to drive out people that aren't taking subsidies, how are we going to have an entirely renewable energy economy when it doesn't stand on its own? How are we going to do that?
First of all, the goal, and correct me if I'm wrong, Madam President, the goal is net zero, not absolute zero.
Right, we're going to import dirty power from other countries.
So no. We don't have to. Every single molecule of energy, according to our goal in the CLCPA, does not have to be clean energy. But we are transitioning into a primarily clean energy economy, and it does stand on its own when it finally gets up and running. We're at the very beginning of this thing. But let's if you have any more questions. You should address them to the chair.
I'll let.
No, okay.
I'll move on.
Okay.
Let other folks.
And I'll come back to you, Senator Borrello, if you have other questions.
I appreciate it.
Any other members?
I couldn't agree more, though, as to your point around the interconnected grid that we operate within.
Yes.
So we do. We import about 12 to 18% of our electricity needs, our imports. And this particular year, has been quite challenging because if you hadn't noticed, it hasn't rained a whole lot,
yeah.
And our hydroelectric generation is down, as are our imports of hydroelectric generation. So I would only reinforce your point, which is that we do live in a world in which the interconnections with our neighbors may become more important to achieve the reliability that we need because of the fact that indeed we're all transitioning together, right?
So other states are going to be able to burn natural gas and do other things, and that's going to help us power New York.
No, what I am saying is the actual act of interconnecting creates improved reliability. And to the extent that we're importing gas or coal or anything like that, that reflects toward our goals. Obviously, that's how the accounting.
So we're not gonna greenhouse gas emissions aren't gonna be here in New York, and we're gonna feel good about that. We're gonna ramp it up in other states.
Well, the climate law is a consumption-based goal. So to the extent to which we import from other states, and those are dirty states, you're absolutely right.
So this goal is kind of just a feel-good goal, that we're not going to generate power here, we're going to let other states do it.
But what I'm saying is global
greenhouse gas emissions.
What I'm saying is simply that it is a truly part of the accounting and the reporting that we do.
Okay, I'm glad to hear that.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
Hi, thank you so much for joining us today, Commissioner Harris. I just want to ask you a little bit about the transition to renewables for buildings. We passed the All Electric Buildings Act last year, and I know there are some programs that exist to help retrofit buildings that are not new buildings that are being built. I just wanted to ask, how are those programs going? Is there an increase in support for buildings that may be interested in retrofitting for renewables? And how can the legislature support?
Fantastic. Thanks for asking that question. So we are hard at work in implementing the zero emission deconstruction requirements, including a cost effectiveness test that we are advancing through comments right now and that will ultimately be considered through the code council. So that's for new construction and certainly was an important part of getting after the new, the tens of thousands of new builds here in our state. As to the existing buildings, where we're talking, 7 million households or thereabouts, that is a very different challenge that we face as a state, especially since a good bit of our building stock was constructed before there even was an energy code. This is an area that we are deploying significant funding against, and we can advance this through codes also, right, for retrofits and things like that. But I would say this remains an area of particular challenge for our state. The $200 million I referenced as Empower Plus programs, that's a great example of ways in which we're taking that last year, but those funds from last year's budget, now with the federal money coming our way, we're going to have roughly double that amount that we will be deploying in these low to moderate income households. Because in the first instance, you do need to make these homes more efficient, and in some instances secure before you can really get after the topic of electrification. So where we sit today, it has to be scaled up. It just does, even to reach the 2 million goal of the governor's, but also the broader 7 million households across our state.
Thank you. Are there any particular challenges or learnings from Power Plus in the last year, where we say scale up, but anything that might, you know, we might need additional support or attention, maybe like, for example, reaching homes that are owned by like lower income New Yorkers, yeah. Or, yeah, critically.
Yeah, we have to, we definitely have to make this topic of access easy. The term that is used by the federal government is grading funds, meaning that we take in Power Plus, and now with the federal money coming in, we're actually funneling it through that program so that people have an easy way to access all of these rebates and the various funds that are flowing. Really, it comes down to scale, which comes through education and comes through sort of seeing your neighbors doing it. That's really what we're talking about. But we've deployed, last count I had was over 70 million of the 200 million from Empower Plus, so our programs are scaling quite well.
Wow, that's great. That's great to hear. Definitely, of course, if there's additional supports needed from the legislature, always happy to hear. I know you spoke a little bit about this at the hearing, but you know, with some of the recent cancellations for renewable projects, just how is NYSERDA addressing those? Is the rebidding process going to affect rate or rates for repairs? And just again, any support you need from the legislature on that?
Well, we really, as I indicated, the governor's 10-point action plan is something that we have been executing against, and I would say in a very rapid manner, to reset not only the pipeline projects, but the industry at large. The way that these actual contracts work, there's no payment for the generation until they actually generate. As such, you know, from the perspective of implications on rates, there really isn't any until you get online. But we certainly see a future that looks like in the midst of our reset.
I'm sorry, that is the state marching towards a clean energy.
That's the people outside.
I'm sorry.
No, those are that's in opposition. That's the signs. We need a plan, not a ban. Save our natural gas. Thank you. By the way, I gotta go.
I'm sorry.
No, I think that's excitement, but I think that yes, I know we also have more of a conversation around it. No, that's great to hear that we're addressing it.
Any other Senator Manning?
President, a couple quick questions. You know, there's a pilot project where we use excess nuclear energy to start with hydrogen production. Energy production. Can you comment on that, and then also on the small modular nuclear reactors? We did have a meeting with the chairman of ORS, and what does the state need to do to make sure that if there are changes at the federal level that we're ready, I guess, to do that kind of thing? And any predictions on if we're actually moving in that direction as a country? Sorry.
No. Well, first of all, I will have to get the latest on the actual project at the nuclear, you know, the green hydrogen. Well, I guess it'd be the hydrogen production facility. At I kind of remember if went monthly around there. We'll give you the latest on the operation of that facility. You know, we're investing a lot in what we call long-duration energy storage. Hydrogen is a great example of a long-duration energy storage technology because it can be stored, right, and used to produce electricity or anything, you know, other uses when needed. So NYSERDA's innovation team continues to invest in technologies for more than, say, 2 to 4 hours of storage, new chemistries, and other technologies as well. Iron oxide is a great example of the chemistry we're investing in. However, on the topic of nuclear, a different angle very much has been that, as even with the Climate Action Council, we saw what we were looking for, which is significant federal commitment and investment in nuclear technologies. This is not a situation where New York would ever go it alone in really advancing or considering these types of technologies. And so even during the Climate Action Council process, we actually took a look at what the changes might be to some of our modeling if we were to pursue new nuclear technologies around the state. And in doing so, we do see these technologies begin to be deployed, or at least considered, I should say. With a permitting timeline, which at least the federal government is claiming they can permit these in under 10 years, which is quite surprising based on history. So I would say there's two ways in which we're thinking about new nuclear. Number one, the Public Service Commission has a proceeding underway right now in which they're looking at how we achieve the zero emission grid of 2040. It's also part of the climate law. And in doing so, certainly nuclear technologies, will both existing and new, will be part of that proceeding as they may contribute. And out of that would come a view as to the extent to which New York may either, again, consider retaining the existing fleet or expanding through new technologies. So I think that's a proceeding we certainly are contributing to from a technical perspective and a cost perspective. But also, I think out of that would come consideration of future state policy as well.
It was very interesting the other day at the hearing and like that. I appreciate that when you came into my office that we were talking about sewage heat recovery expansion. Very important. Hopefully Stony Brook will be first of its kind. Green hydrogen, which you already know about, I really appreciate that. Looking for other sources of renewable energy. Geothermal, pink nuclear power. I'm glad we talked about nuclear power today. But what about retooling our power plants for carbon capture to retool that? That would probably be the most efficient way of looking into, obviously, renewable energies. Are we looking into anything about retooling our existing power plants with carbon capture?
So the proceeding that I just referenced, the zero emission proceeding at the Public Service Commission, one of the first questions that they've asked, actually, that's out for public comment right now, is what should a zero emission asset be? What attributes should it have, and how does it relate to the climate law, which is a DEC enforcement mechanism, versus the public service law, which is the Public Service Commission purview? And out of that would come a situation, just like I mentioned hydrogen, just like I mentioned nuclear, just like there might be renewable natural gas, in your example, carbon capture, we would need to basically test technologies against those definitions. New York's climate law, as you well know, has very specific constraints as it relates to emissions, and fundamentally, that's where the consideration of other technologies would be taken up.
All right, so that is something that would be a consideration.
At least there's a world of options. They'd be compared against the definition.
Okay, how do you feel, we all know what happened with Berkeley, California, with the lawsuit that was, the appeal was denied. How do you feel about the lawsuit that right now is pending with all New York State with banning of our natural gas? And I'm hoping that, in other words, it's going to happen, so we understand that it is against federal law, it's against the Constitution of the United States to ban natural gas. Do you have any concerns on this?
Yeah, obviously I can't comment on litigation, but I obviously monitoring the situation in Berkeley, I would say our assessment is it's not dispositive on New York's law. However, our work continues. As I had indicated, we have advanced our cost-effective rule. That's out for public comment, and that would advance toward the next steps for the code council.
Okay, so right, I know you're aware of that. And just as we discussed before also too, that what are we doing right now when we have a capacity shortage, and we have trucks, diesel trucks right now going across bridges with frozen natural gas going through this to actually pump into the system, to force them to pump it into the system. Is there any talks or any concerns? I know we discussed this, but I was just wondering if you could elaborate on that, because that's to me, something that's very interesting that we could go right now and have diesel trucks trucking in frozen natural gas.
I would need to better understand the situation you're describing, but as a general matter, what I have observed in my world is that every energy option comes with challenges as relates to various aspects of reliability.
Yeah, so
cold weather impacts fuels for certain.
I another, but then we think that in other words we need to make sure, because it's against federal law also too, you have a capacity problem that you need by federal law, that you need to make sure you supply the right source of energy coming into your state. And that is a, that is another block, in other words, that is being broken, that we are not allowing a pipeline come in, or Williams pipeline, messy pipeline that was denied. Now I spoke to you also.
Just a question of fact. The Williams pipeline wasn't a new pipeline coming in, it was actually a upgrade of an existing pipeline.
No, it was coming in.
It
was a new pipeline coming in. Brooklyn is the best. It was coming through the state of New Jersey.
But it was an upgrade of an existing line. It wasn't a brand new line.
And the DEC actually stopped that from coming in.
Correct.
So I'm actually, to be honest with you, I'm having a question to the president. So, and it also too, we're going to be looking into why 3 years, why we're not moving forward with the Iroquois pipeline. We're going to be looking into that, why that hasn't been moving forward to bring that extra capacity in.
I'd point you to the commissioner for DC.
Okay, we're going
to
do that. But I'm saying you're going to be involved with that. I just want to make sure it's on record with that. The other, you know, I know we have other people that are here speaking. The other day, we were speaking, and I really didn't get into it. We didn't get to a chance. And by the way, I have some great files for everything, which I know that my friend Rich Ellenbogen sends all this information to you. Matter of fact, I have it all for you, Senator, by the way. Here's a nice, this is going to be all for your reading. This way you're not too big, thick. Just to give you a heads up, why it's going to cost triple to quadruple the rates. And the other day, President, when we were speaking, the last thing I asked the question was, who is going to be paying for this experiment that's going on with wind and solar and battery storage, which we discussed the other day? There's people that they're leaving. They're not coming in. They're not moving forward with their projects. And I was wondering, the last thing you did say, I think if I'm saying this right, you did say that, in other words, know that it's not going to cost the ratepayers for 2 to 3 times more for their electric bills.
That was my answer. My answer was
it's not going to cost the ratepayers.
My answer was really relating to the, your question had, at least as I understood it, to be related to our Cap and Invest program.
No. I'm talking about all New Yorkers that are going to be paying 2 to 3 times their electric rates for wind, solar, and battery storage. It's going to cost trillions of dollars, not billions. Matter of fact, I know you received all this. This, guess what, is facts and figures, which you've known this. Matter of fact, this gentleman has been in discussions with all the Cornell professors about all this. He has them baffled. And they say it's going to cost more than what he is saying. So my question again is, so you're saying you have to invest certain people that make how much money, by the way? What is their income have to be yearly before they can actually get this program?
So we had modeled it at 80% of AMI for the rebate program that we advanced collectively last year.
So again, I have a lot of middle class people, in other words, yes, I'm doing food insecurities, I'm doing food banks. And I know Senator Parker said, Brooklyn is amazing, it's doing unbelievable. So I really got to really focus on how my senator really has everybody, because I have food insecurities, I have people that can't even, they're having a hard time going to the supermarket to put food on the table. Their rates to go up triple to quadruple will be devastating. And guess what? More people are exiting, we all know it, more than ever. In any state in the whole United States, we have everybody exiting out of here because of these all mandates. And I want to know, the other question I have is, how are we advertising it to let our public know? Every time I speak to my public, they have no idea what's happening with this gas mandate. They have no idea what's happening, in other words, with the CLCPA, which I understand you have a job to do. They have no idea. What are we doing to really get out to the public to let them know that this is happening? I know what I do in my district. Are we doing a good job, you feel?
Well, first of all, on the topic of cost, I assume this came up in the hearing before the Public Service Commission Chair Christian, but every year they do a report to the commission on the costs of the CLCPA. So just if you wanted to look back to last year's report, this recent information.
Again, things change.
Yes, which
President,
is why they do it.
Changing every day will cost.
Which is why they do it.
And that's the reason why we have people that are pulling out of solar projects. That's why we have people pulling out of the battery storage projects. Because they're not going to be, seriously, it's about making money. And they're not going to be making any money because they realize that, in other words, the cost for materials and everything are double to triple. And guess what? They're not going to be receiving it. So they're bailing. So what are we doing about that?
Senator, I want to answer your question. I'm not sure which one you want me to answer. But
okay, I get a lot of them. I'm sorry.
I agree on the topic of public information, though.
Yes, you have to do a better job. People don't know. I think in Brooklyn they know, though.
They do.
Brooklyn.
So, unfortunately, we're running out of time in this room. Senator Hinchin, you have a question?
Thank you. When we said you could go first, Senator Matera, I didn't realize it would be the rest of the meeting.
That's why I wanted you to go!
Switching gears just for a quick second. I know we only have a couple minutes left. Thank you for being here and for your work. I wanted to just quickly touch. I know you are engaging with schools on electric school buses. We have a lot of communities and schools that want to engage and they want to learn, they want to purchase, but they're struggling, they're wondering where to go. Can you talk a little bit about the work that you're doing with schools and how you can ramp that up with school districts across the state?
Yes, definitely. So we have connected with all 700 school districts. And I would say on a deeper level, we've seen applications come in from about 150 right now. So that's a good percentage, but to your point, it is not sufficient. And what we are learning, of course, is also that this needs to be a relationship, right? A multi, in some cases, decade relationship in which we're not only executing on plans, but executing against those plans at the same time. So we have a number of different opportunities that we are scaling up so that our staff can be a resource, but also I think the other question that is really coming forward with these school districts is the ways in which they need to interact with their utilities. And so the Department of Public Service and the utilities themselves are building out capacity to support, I'll call it an ombudsperson, right, to really work directly with the districts as well. So it's being scaled up because we need to, not only to get to all the schools, but to see them through the journey.
Thank you.
Anything else, Senator?
I'll end on time.
All right, good. First, let me thank President Harris for making time to be here for answering the questions and being very transparent. I want to thank my colleagues for your interesting and engaging questions. Senator Felder, I don't know if you had a question.
I was going to ask you when your committee is going to be finished.
We're wrapping up as we speak, Senator Felder. Who probably is here for the health committee. I'm like, he's not on this committee, but I'm like, he's here. So maybe just came to see you. I know you'd like to come to see me, but I thought maybe you came to see President Harris.
But that's obvious. That's obvious.
Thank you for being here either way. Again, thank you for being here, and this adjourns this meeting of the Standing Senate Committee on Energy and Telecommunications. Excellent.